on Nuwa, right? But there's some high level stuff. We're giving Ref way too much credit today.
Let's go into picks and bans for game two of Epsilon versus Titan. Epsilon performed very well in that. Already qualified as number one seed for the regionals. 24-1 is their record right now. Titan, after that game, slipped to 12-13, I believe.
Yes, they were 12-12 heading into this one. 12-13 games against LC.
So can Titan tie this up with a split here and make it 13-13 again for them? Or will Epsilon continue with only losing one game this split?
Titan putting a lot of respect into that Neath that Epsilon likes to run, banning it out. And once again, Epsilon going to be taking away the hell that I would say Titan as a team like to run.
Sirkat on the table.
Sirkat was
Kepri,
the last time. Last
Sun Wukong. They're the three that you're looking at here.
So Sirkat was actually banned out last time. However, this time we actually have Titan in first pick and Epsilon. They recognized how useful Kepri was to them. They're going to ban it away from
So Epsilon are very respectful of the Kepri, it seems. They're actually worried about it.
It's a pick they clearly value over some of the other top picks. You know, Sounds, Sirkat, and... Oh, actually,
however,
over Sirkat.
Titan valuing Sun Wukong over Sirkat here, which we see Sirkat picked up more often than not ahead of Sun Wukong if they're both available.
We do know Adapting loves to run this god, but it's a little bit risky here because Titan aren't going to basically be able to read him directly if that's what they want to go into, but it's going to be the Nox locked in.
Epsilon going to take that one away from Titan, and they're also going to take away the Thor that Repicast ran as well, so Epsilon switching this up a little bit, trying to take away a few picks from Titan here. We've seen these run both.
Epsilon love this combo more than anything. The Nox Thor, you can just have insane burst on individual targets, and if they have no beads up, they are guaranteed dead, right? If you do not have beads and a Thor lands his dunk on you with the Nox inside, there is absolutely no way you're getting out unless they completely mess up the combo.
Well, this, I believe, will be the 11th game of the season if this goes to Adapting that he's played Thor, and the performances he has on that god is absolutely unreal. Athena locks in across the way for a little bit more global presence to counteract this Thor combo that's available.
Athena also very strong against Thor, being able to taunt out Berserker's Barrage and lock him in place.
And obviously, as well, the Shadow Step that Nox can do. She can actually go inside Thor and then ult with him into a big fight. That would be a lovely play to see if we ever see one of those.
Apollo going to be going to Ninja Demi there, and Epsilon actually going to be banning out Nuwa. So,
well, all being well, they keep the role swap, because I'm not 100% certain if they do it, if they're going to do it for both games, but they definitely did it game one. Will they do it for game two?
I'm assuming they would, especially after how successful it was in game one.
Ares actually banned away from Rafa here, so they don't believe that's a Thor support for 1 second, which neither would I when you've got Adapting on the team.
No, Adapting is probably, if not the best Thor in the game next to Season 1 Garz. Not Season 2 Garz, but Season 1 Garz was the best player on Thor in the world. I think Adapting is someone who matches that.
Geb going to be locked in for Epsilon there, so that definitely will go over to Rafa in the support role. Titan, two picks remaining, looking for a mid and probably I guess it's jungler here, unless we see Sun Wukong in the jungle again.
Which we've seen that a couple times from Envy as well. Well, it's been Envy and Eager in North America that have run it. It's Dare to Care and, Weaken. We'll have to see, though. Final picks coming in for Titan. Vulcan locked in for Pretty Prime, so one of his go-tos that we haven't seen in a long time.
No, it's been quite a while since we've actually seen him pick that one up, but it's good to see him go back to that. Because one thing about Vulcan that a lot of people don't take into account is that big ultimate that he's got. That ultimate can secure Gold Furies and Fire Giants from a long distance away. And actually, with that Kabrakan pickup, if that's going to be Jungle Kabrakan here, the combo with the wall, which pins off your escape route, can confirm damage for Vulcan so very, very easily.
Hades. Last pick, that's going to be going to Immolito more than likely, as long as the role swaps haven't
changed.
Oh, no, that's true. We have seen some teams run Hades mid.
Well, I mean, what would you prefer to run against a Vulcan here? Would you prefer to run a Nox, or would you run a Hades here, if you had to choose one? I think I'd rather run Hades, I would say.
In the mid?
Yeah. Up against a Vulcan, I'd rather run Hades.
We're going to find out who it is. No, it's going to be Yamen on the Nox. This might be a god that Immolito hasn't practiced. It could just be a god pool thing.
Well, push power must definitely go to Pretty Prime in the mid lane, right?
Early on, for sure. I mean, Nox has a lot of damage, but it's not like I use one ability and my damage is done. Mm-hmm. It's I need the creeps to kind of sit in that silence for a little bit to make sure that it explodes after the two-second timer. But, you know, a lot of the times with early game push, you also have to look at who your jungler is. And Thor versus Kabrakan, I would give it to Thor.
But at the same time,
when
they combine together, I still feel that Titan should have push power in mid.
At least early on, there's a lot of kill potential for both these teams, though. And I don't expect to see either team push the issue unless they feel that the other squad has really put themselves in a bad position.
A lot of aggression out of Emilito here. Looks like he's going for a very, very quick Warlock Sash in this lane. Up against a Sun Wukong. So Sun Wukong early against Hades, should he be trying to punish this potentially because he's only starting with this one health potion?
See Brotos actually going 5 health potions and a power potion. I do expect to see Brotos be very aggressive just based on this build. Yeah, he's got a lot of sustain. So I think he just wants to fight Emilito and force him out early to make sure that he cannot get that Warlock Sash online as quickly as possible.
So it's 1,450 gold, I believe, to upgrade to Warlock Sash. So it should be quite a way away from Emilito hitting it, especially if you can force him back to base a little bit earlier on here. Camp started off, as you'd normally expect, both mid laners picking up their red buffs and rotating to mid. And they should relatively get there about the same time, because obviously Ho Yi's wave clear early on in the jungle, very effective at helping out.
A lot of times it's the order side that takes a little bit longer to get to lane. But yeah, that wave clear with the Vulcan turret and Hu Yi triple bounce, so fast.
A rotation coming out from Epsilon already, because the Adaptin has already cleared out the blue buff.
And oh, look at this. Titan, they're trying to abuse solo lane. They want Emilito to dash into the wave. Look at Repikas sit in this jungle. But Brotos is pushing up the wave, and Repikas is losing a lot for this. Like, Brotos almost should have given Emilito the chance.
The rotation, though, coming out on the other side from Konya Life is very wise to secure those left-hand harpies, knowing...
I want to watch this solo lane here. Well, I want to watch this solo lane.
He's going to soak some experience this time around through that wall. Hopefully, we can see Repikas get a little bit here.
I'm really surprised that Brotos is pushing up this wave when it is clear that the plan is to bait Emilito's dash.
But look at this rotation from Adaptin back over.
That is so much waste of time from Titan. That was poor communication or poor execution of their plan.
What was Repi's plan? Were they hoping just to dash in? Because he's not got blink at the start of the game.
So they wanted to fight.
How's he going to get in there at level 2?
Sun Wukong has a lot of lockdown. He's got a slow on Master's Will. He's got a stun on the Tiger Cat. Raffer, though, might be first blood. Getting pretty low here at Araxia. Doing a lot of poke. He'll be fine, but... no health potions left for Raffer. He's got them all activated on
himself. He actually went for mana potions here, not multi potions as well. So he's not going to be ticking up as much health as you'd expect. Raffer's going to probably be sat about 50% here. Keep an eye on him, because if he doesn't go back to base, he could be a casualty of war if another taunt ricochet combo comes out from the Boys of Titan.
Repikas has rotated out of that solo lane, though, just looking for experience. You can see he's a level down right now. Actually, more than a level. He's just barely into level 3 after that wave, though.
He's not going to hurt too much on a Kubrakan, though, is it? I mean, once he's level 5, he's still going to do what he wants.
It's fine. The thing for me is Adapting actually going to take advantage? Once he's 5, Kubrakan can't realistically fight, right? There's that one level window where a huge advantage is going to be in favor of Epsilon and Adapting, and it's whether Adapting will take that window.
I'm not sure. Did Brotos just ignore that stun by using From Below? He used his wand to
escape. I wasn't sure. I didn't notice.
I think he just escaped the cats and dealt damage back. But on the left-hand side, Raffer taking a lot of poke. Dimmy returning the favor, though, and going very aggressive. Look at this. Adapting's gone to the sky. He's trying to close the gap, but he was just out of range.
If he hadn't done back harpies and rotated to the fight, but I don't think he was expecting that to happen too much. There was the window that Epsilon and Adapting have. That window is now over, so the early game misplay Repikas will recover from, although he is a little bit behind in gold and experience still.
Well, it's a good matchup this between Titan and Epsilon, because when you look back at last year, Titan were the story of the year from EU.
Oh, yeah.
This year, it's all been about Epsilon.
The
year's gone on.
Titan, you know, just barely missed out on SPL Season 1. They were like the 6th, or they were like the 7th or 8th ranked team. It came down to the last week. They weren't able to win their game. Moving forward, they fought through the Challengers Cup as Aquila, then Agilitas, and then, Aquila. And then second place at Worlds. But then since then, they haven't 2-0'd a single top-tier team in Europe.
And Epsilon, they've had a very similar story in terms of forming in the Challenger Cup, coming through the Challenger Cup, hitting the SPL last season.
Yes.
Didn't do great there because they had internal issues with Raffer being punished for naughtiness, is what I'm going to call it.
Naughtiness.
That is. That's right.
We need a naughty Raffer skin.
And then, a naughty Raffer skin. That's it. He needs a naughty Raffer emo. That's what he needs. And then, since then, this split, the teams were worried about them last split, and they were very lucky with the ban that came through. Well, not lucky, but it's their own fault for Epsilon. But because that happened, we didn't see them at the LAN last time around. They had a chance of getting there, failed to make it. Now, though, everyone's talking about them Worlds and the North American Giants.
Epsilon looks so much better in the fall split than they did in the summer. You know, they had dropped a couple games early. Mm-hmm. They were still a top-tier team now, and I believe 8-4 at the end of it, although 3 losses came while iRaffer was banned. However, they're winning games so much more cleanly in the fall split in the summer. Summer, their games were very close. Fight breaking out, though, iRaffer shielding himself. Actually locked in a corner now.
Locked in a corner indeed, but he just managed to get away. Oh, that Vulcanoa was not on point from Pretty Prime. He didn't expect him to burst through the wall so quickly.
He auto. This is something you don't ever see against Kabrakins. A lot of players just immediately panic. Iraffer auto attacks the wall. Same with Yamen.
That's right.
And they blow up the wall, and Iraffer can just walk out. And that's actually something that Titan probably didn't even expect.
Yamen was the key there because he was auto attacking the wall. It's one of those things that he did to support the team. Obviously, Rafi should attack it, but Yamen attacking it was really what made the impact there.
What
about
this?
Adaptins in the sky, though. Going to try and make a play. There's a big rotation from Titan here as well, though. As Emilito does get the ultimate off, they're going to force the Suncloud on Brotus. No kills down just yet. And with a lot of ultimates wasted, Brotus should be able to get out, I say. Yes. He will, just about.
Barely. Repikov's going to be playing defender for him. Adapting! Ooh. No! That would have been dirty if he hit that double tap. I don't know if the damage would have been there, but it would have been close. Kanye Life doesn't want to give up this blue buff just yet, and Epsilon as well. Think better of it.
That's a lot of respect from Epsilon there, because they didn't realize Prime had gone back to base, Brotus had gone back to base. It was a 2v4 scenario there for
Not
Epsilon
worth the risk for
to
them.
Potentially steal the blue, and the speed.
That should have been first blood, though, in my opinion, on Adapting. He came crashing down and prioritized Athena. Meanwhile, Brotus immediately ulted into that Somersault Cloud, and I think if, as a team, Epsilon had focused him out, he would have died before he got up in the air. He was sitting at, like, less than 5% XP, so the call probably not on the right target, but still Epsilon taking small advantages where they can. Only 400 gold ahead, though. This is not a big lead.
Let's look at the experience as well, because last time around, we saw a bit of a difference between the two teams. This time, though, completely even.
Levels that, even across the board, I would say, outside of the jungle.
Go back to experience, though, Adonis, because Repikas early on, he didn't get much in that solo lane, right?
He's still behind in experience. Repikas is still behind adapting in experience, but I think that just means there's an experience lead somewhere else for Titan to even it up. It's almost negligible. I mean, both these players are so close.
Yeah, but look at the experience per minute there. You can see that there's a couple of members of Titan just a little bit further ahead than the main.
A lot of it's prime there.
Yeah.
A lot of it's prime. 100 XP per minute
on
Yamen.
You drop the turret and you walk away and you still get experience. Very, very effective. And gold.
So OP. Vulcan OP.
Is he?
No.
Why is he not OP?
He's not OP. Because he does a lot of damage, but it can be avoided pretty easily. He has a lot of burst.
Well, since we changed the meatball as well, because the meatball had a few iterations. Taunt in mid lane, though. Immediate shield comes out from Rafa in response.
Was that a beads from Kanye?
Yeah, Kanye beads.
That's a 3-minute cooldown.
So beads do go down right inside. Brotus did make a rotation for those right harpies. It looks like he's going to pick one of them up. No, one of them went down and one went in favor of
Brotus is in trouble. His ultimate is available, but he's getting pinched. He recognizes it very quickly. Ox forms out of that one.
So, right harpy's got split, left harpy's due to spawn in a second. Battle of wills between these two teams so far. It's generally going to be a farm off, but it doesn't look like the either team just want to farm. They want to actually try and fight all the time.
Epsilon, very aggressive positioning, and Titan doesn't really give them anything. They'll make sure they don't get pinched in awkward corners, but Titan are always ready to fight as a team.
Wall.
Nice wall, simply to make sure Epsilon secure those mid harpies.
So they do, and Epsilon actually come away with a little bit of experience in gold lead there. Taunting mid lane onto Yamen, immediate shield from Rafa. Adapting to try and punish them for their over-aggression now. He's going to look for Kanye, he's got no beads, he has to ult. Going to be onto Repikas, who's been locked in place. The Cataclysm connects with both of them. Pretty Prime over the top with the ultimate comes in to pick up one, though, as Dimmy rotates all the way in to pick up Repikas, a 2-for-1 trade in favor of Epsilon.
Repikas running right back into the fight when Kanye Life was trying to get out there, and that was just Epsilon timing it perfectly. The second that Kanye Life came crashing down on top of Repikas, we saw the Cataclysm come out from Raffer, and then all of Epsilon combined. They secure first blood. They do lose adapting in the process from Pretty Prime's burst, but they come out on top of that clearly.
And I think the Sentry Ward over by the left-hand Gold Furies here, Harpies here, is the big impact, because Titan didn't have vision that the boys of Epsilon were still hanging around that area. Rafa's shield that set off after the taunt onto Yamen in the mid lane set up Titan to be in an awkward position against Epsilon. And the cataclysm that followed was huge from Rafa.
Titan, they wanted to fight but just didn't have the vision, and Epsilon responding nicely. Taking a look here, they're at the Gold Fury. Just looks like they want a ward. They're actually going to start it up. I don't think they're going to stay on this for too long. The Gold Fury actually took a lot of damage. Oh, my word.
Brotus has made a rotation, too. So there's five members of Titan here. You can see that Yamen now on the way back from base as well. Still five members here. But look at the tower in the right-hand side. Emilito's pushed a full wave in there. And that should probably die to this mini wave, I believe.
Both of these Soul Laners have teleport, but they're both down at this time. It's going to be close. It looks like there's a pretty decent-sized wave in there, but the way. Oh, no, Titan, Tier 1 tower going to survive.
He's not going to survive, but now Epsilon have the opportunity to be able to overhear as well. Emilito has arrived up here 9 minutes, 30 seconds in. And Brotus, well, he's going to find out the goal view is gone. Titan were in a position to defend it. They got
that
it for free.
That was just something you don't really see from Titan typically. We saw it in game one. Now we saw it in game two. Titan, they're trying to respond though on left-hand side. Dimmy, I don't think he's aware that this rotation is here. Kanye Life going to hit the taunt. No beads available for Dimmy. He's locked in place. Tectonic Rift. But now he's being chased. He's got I-Raptor to support him. Fantastic. Cataclysm. There's the shield as well. Dimmy's actually fighting into this. He actually might find return kills. Ataraxia is locked down. Repikos, the new target. Dimmy, double kill for him, turns around the 1v3, Epsilon responding so fast.
They're responding very, very quickly, and a lot of credit has to go to Adaptin and Rafa for that. But Dimmy, let's be honest, we talked about how little he dies in games and how much time he spends dead. Well, you don't spend much time, so you don't spend a lot of time dead if you can escape like that.
1v3, I mean, to be fair, he wouldn't have got it out if it was if remained a 1v3, but he stood tall, he understood that Epsilon, the rest of his team, was rotating
right
in, and he fought there.
He rotated to his team instead of towards the tower and try and walk around the wall. And he went straight towards his teammates.
Realistically, too, he could have turned around, auto-attacked the Kabrakan wall, and then quickly got out. But instead, he baits Titan into that small corridor. Cataclysm hits two or three, and the Epsilon, they find two kills.
And Adaptin turn up for that opportunity
as well. Dimmy again rotating.
Big knock-up hits as well, and Prime's going to be bursted down there, locked in place thanks to the Shadow Lock coming out from Shadow from Yamin. Why did I say Shadow Nightmare?
I don't know.
Because it's Shadow Lock, that's
what it is.
Confusing.
It's also, there's like four shadows, and there's a ton of knights in her kit as well, like her passive and her alt.
And Repikos on the right-hand side now, going to go back to his jungle and look to pick up the buffs. Emilito's around here. Let's have a look at the jungle comparison, though, between Repikos and Adapting as well. You can see that on your screen as Epsilon are currently invading this. KDA of 12.5.
I mean, Epsilon as a team, I think, has like an 8 average, and Adapting being a big part of that. He actually, I believe, was 48 kills last week. He had a 18.5 and 48 kills last week.
Oh, mid lane aggression coming out from Emilito here. He's in big, and he's going to get a big ultimate off. Repikos is in a lot of trouble, being bursted down. The tower's whacking away at Emilito, but he doesn't care. His Adapting dunks down. Yamin going to find the kill on Brotus. Prime's ultimate did not find home. And two kills once again to Epsilon. They're pressuring for a tier one.
They definitely want this tier one, and the turret's down for pretty prime. He needs to be careful here. Rotation coming from Ataraxia. Three left to defend against four. Iraffer going to tank tower for a second, but it's not that big of a deal. Nice taunt by Kanye Life. Emilito staying a little bit too long. He's going to fall. Titan find a return kill and defend their tier one.
But Dimmy just rotate all the way in there, use his ultimate, change his mind.
Okay, Dimmy.
I guess that was more for the rotation in case the fight continues more than anything else. But he's not going to be able to help hold the mid lane down here. Meatball Mariana connects from Pretty Prime there. The taunt from Kanye is good onto two members. Dimmy took a lot of poke, but a good shield from Rafa will stop him taking too much more.
Kanye needs to be pretty careful here. Brotus, he's rotated back full, and now it's Titan taking the tier 1 tower, and it looks like Emilito, Epsilon are going to give this one up. Kanye Life going to taunt into Raffer. Can't Titan find the burst? Not in time.
Kanye Life was so low.
Raffer
will find the burst. He was attacking the tower as well. Repikos tries
Brotus to use
the drummers.
Brotus almost dies to tower,
Brotus
too.
Brotus going to get chased down by Dimmy. Now the move's getting the chase. That's a great meatball over the wall,
Adapting,
though. But will they find the kills?
Adapting come crashing down. He's going to go on Repikos. He finds that one. In the meantime, we saw Brotus get locked down by the rest of Epsilon. That double tap and the juke. Not going to get knocked up by the meatball. Ulting in place. Pretty prime. He's just doing no damage to Adapting, juking every single one of his abilities. Epsilon, 10 kills to 2. They're going to take this tier 1 in mid. And
they should be able to.
Titan, they are not looking good right now.
Look at the right-hand side. We're going to see Dimmy rotate over there. He's probably going to backdoor that if he can find it. Just two hits should be enough. Minimum.
Three. We were both wrong.
I'm bad at this.
I said one. You said two.
Oh, wow.
Well, if you add our numbers up, that's what we were going for.
Okay.
Let's at least save once. All right?
Epsilon 10 to 2. Under 14 minutes in this game right now. Let's have a look at the experience in gold, because only one gold crew has gone down, but look at this lead once again.
8,000.
So good.
Once again, Adapting three levels in the jungle, a couple levels on Emilito in the solo lane, one level on Pretty Prime, dual lane as well. It's just a couple levels on each player.
It's such a strange situation to see this as well, because last year we talked about Titan and how involved in kills they are. Kill participation as a team.
They're the highest, 2.75.
And now if you compare that to Epsilon, I'm pretty sure there's a big differential there.
I actually want to go back and calculate that, because that was Titan's big thing. They fought as a unit. They fought as four or five members
every time.
Single time. Massive rotations and big wins as a team.
I'm pretty sure their average, I'm not sure if it was two, I think it was higher than that. I think it was three kills. Three members of a team were involved in a kill on average.
It was close. They were the highest by far, by an absurd amount.
Epsilon, they must be really high up there too, especially because they've not been dying that much, which means they're living longer. Adapting
almost has 100% kill participation in every single game. Crazy. Yaman's close as well. Ataraxia, nowhere for him to go. Might be able to get away with the protection of the tower.
Lincoln,
they want to fight though.
Good wall onto Dimmy as well. Dimmy's trapped in a world of hurt. He will be punished for his transgressions. Prime picks up the kill.
And you can see the rest of Epsilon noticing that Dimmy was almost guaranteed dead. Back off and make sure that they don't lose any more. They don't allow Titan to force a fight and they have odd numbers.
Doing good work. Torn in, on to adapting. The meatball followed as well. Yamin's now raking this rotation too. Titan looking for more, but Epsilon doing very well.
If Titan want to force something, they have to do it now. Dimmy is up in 20 seconds and he has his ultimate. We see a back out from adapting. This is a small window Titan has to abuse the numbers advantage. The question is whether they will or not. It looks like they want to.
Kanye's got taunt available. He'll
they
be
need
the
to do it now.
The tower as well.
They're
there
giving
you
too
go.
Much time.
Look at the top. Blinking from Rafa though with a cataclysm to follow to stop the follow up. Brotus took a lot of burst damage. Adapted. He's in the sky. He dunks in, looking for the pick onto Prime, who beads immediately and disengages. Still, Rappycast on the front line will fall down, followed by... No, nobody. I expect another member to fall down there. Brotus on the backside, chased down by Rafa Emilito, zoning out. Dimmy is back in the fight, though, and the bird may fall.
Brotus going to get stunned out there. Dimmy finds the kill. Meanwhile, Emilito was trying to fight 1v3. Did he take someone out? No, I don't think so. Only
Gulf
one...
Fury. Has been started here as well by Dimmy. Just to note, Dimmy did die this game. So maybe it's affected his standing and the average of 1 minute dead every 70 minutes.
Yeah, because we're only 16 minutes in here.
Exactly.
Average going down.
Made a big impact there, but Gold Fury is going in the way of Epsilon here. It doesn't look like Titan will get a chance to defend it. Ataraxia being zoned away. Gold Fury falls and Epsilon extend their lead.
Wow. 6,700 gold, 8,400 experience. It wasn't a wide margin gain. Titan, they had the opportunity. They had a 5v3, but they took so long to force the engagement, so long that it was actually Irafer who forced the engagement because Adapting had by then rotated back into the fight and was in position. Dimmy came off spawn a couple seconds later, ults into the fight. That was just Titan, I don't want to say scared, right? Because they were ready to fight. They just took a little bit too long to pull the trigger, and they lost it because of it.
In the jungle as well, Rappycast currently 0-5. He's not managed to find much this game again. Not as far behind in experience as he was at this stage against Epsilon last game, but the Kubrakan's not really making the impact they're looking for, I feel.
0-5-2. I mean, Rappycast has been in all these fights, but he's locked down a couple targets, but they just immediately get out of his ult. There's only been one successful time, and that was at the left-hand side there in that last engagement, or before the last fight broke out, able to lock down Dimmy. Outside of that,
Rafa,
nothing big.
Followed by a meatball. The silence from Yamin will buy him a second, though. Cataclysm has to be used by Rafa, and the wall's going to pin him in an awkward spot. The shield bought him a second, and they brought down the wall so he could escape.
That's exactly what we saw earlier. Now, Epsilon, they're going to be able to turn this one. Pretty Prime Beads able to get out of that silence, but Adapting doing so much damage in the middle of the fight with Berserker's Barrage. One more hit. Ataraxia's rotation finds Irad for Adapting.
Going to
lock down Prime, but Rappycast might keep
big
him alive.
Stun. Big no. stun, but Adapting does pick him up. Rappycast gets adapted in response. Dimmy, though, is going to rotate in with Rappycast. He's in a world of hurt. Brotus turns up to support his jungler, but it looks like he may end up falling too.
Emilito still has ult. Brotus takes to the sky, but it's one player. Kanye Life locked down. Brotus actually crashes into the team. He wants to fight, but already Kanye Life's down. He's in the middle of three players. Titan, they lose four, only getting two. Epsilon continuing to win these fights a little bit at a time.
And they look to burst down Rafa in the engagement, and they didn't find the kill. Rafa escapes, the fight continues, but Adapting comes back in. But then Rafa ended up back in the fight, and they focused him again to try and finish him off, but it put them in an awkward spot.
This Kabraka pick in the jungle is really what's not working for Titan right now. Not necessarily Rappycast.
I don't think it's Rappycast's play. It just feels like they wanted to wombo combo with the Vulcan.
But
right?
Epsilon is responding perfectly to it. And also it does seem like Rappycast and Pretty Prime synergy is not there. Pretty Prime waiting a second or two to ultimate. It's not like Tectonic Rift comes out as Vulcan's ult is crashing down. It's kinda like Tectonic Rift, okay. All right, now Volcanoes.
It's a bit more of an awkward combo than what you've seen of like a Thor into a Ross Knight.
Yes.
Whereas this one is going
to
be...
It's definitely harder to synergize. It's going to
be placed perfectly, because if it's not, then the people could just walk around the wall and escape your ultimate anyway. So I guess that's why you've seen that extra second of doubt in Prime's mind before we've seen fire the ultimate.
Twice now, though, we saw the same play at that Mid-Harpies. Lock Raffer in, we saw it in the first couple minutes, and then we saw it just there in, I believe, the 17th minute. And twice, Yamin and Raffer auto-attack. It was the same wall, too, right? It was that second one from the left. They auto-attack that, and Raffer rolls out. That's twice now.
Guess out of trouble again. Brotus back to the solo lane here. Try to push it up a little bit.
Should be safe.
But Emilito is definitely there to respond and stop them, pressuring a tier 1.
His ultimate's down, but Epsilon not going to chase him a little bit too far. A lot of counter warding coming out. Titan actually double-placing wards. I'm assuming one's probably going
to
be falling
off.
What
does this say about Epsilon, where they're able to have the solo laner and the Hunter switch roles in a game and perform as well as they have done?
I mean, Dimmy is 7-1-5. He's played fantastic. Once again, Titan trying to focus down Iraffer. Iraffer under half life. Good poke, but Kanye life was poked out as well.
But however, Kanye can go back to base and get straight back to the fight.
Yes.
Raph is going to be a little bit longer on that. If they look to engage Titan, they may have an opportunity 4v5. At least for a few seconds, there's a Taunt and Melito. Tanky Guardian target. They bursted him hard, but he does escape for now.
Two players that have been poked out, but Titan a little bit wary of diving straight in, and I tend to agree with them here. They don't want to risk diving too deep. They're finding some nice poke and some nice burst, but this is kind of them being a little bit too far behind. So they're not able to lock down these targets they should be able to.
Emilito very wise there. Didn't go back to base, just went into the blue buff and healed himself up off that for the most part.
Now he's going
to
back, though. He has teleport.
He does have teleport to get back as
teleport
well.
Teleport 2. Sash, that's going to be teleport 3 more than likely. Yeah.
So a good lineup for that of Epsilon at the moment. They're looking to zone around the fire giant, clear out wards and turrets, especially from giving any sort of vision.
Titan playing so passively in their own jungle. Epsilon giving them a lot of respect. Don't want to force the issue so far. You can see Adapting looking to just push up the mid in the meantime. Lead isn't being extended at all.
And the big key for Epsilon here is they can't even attempt Fire Giant when Vulcan's alive.
It's so risky.
If Vulcan hits,
not only
the,
it's not even the steal, it's just the damage that all the players would take.
On top of that, but
right,
Kanye gets a little bit caught there, has to use his preemptive strike away. They do lock him in place, though, does Yamin, and that allows some nice damage coming out from Dimmy. That's forced the ultimate, but he's already bursted down. Jeez, that's a lot of damage.
Four players left alive, and Iraffer's going to find three of them. Two beats, three beats forced. Iraffer stuck under tower. There's the Vulcan ult, but once again, Iraffer just auto-attacks the wall, walks out of it. And now Pretty Prime has no ult for this fight. Epsilon knows it. They're going to force something. I don't know if it's going to be Fire Giant, or I don't know if it's going to just be baiting for the engagement, but now Titan, they're gonna have a rough time fighting into this one. Kanye life coming off a death in 10 seconds. His ultimate is up, though.
Are they gonna try and defend this? They have to. Pretty Prime in the area doesn't have his ultimate, as we mentioned. Emilito going in deep, gonna pull them all in. Three beads were wasted when we saw Cataclysm go off from Rafa, and that means Yamin will pick up Prime. Suncloud has been used, and Rappikas is gonna bravely run away with those giant shields, but he's gonna find a wall in his way and fall down too.
Small little play there, didn't even matter. Yamin actually jumps inside Emilito, who dashes over the wall. Yamin utilizing his shadow step very efficiently. Repikos dead, Pretty Prime dead. Three left to defend this Fire Giant, but Epsilon are continuing to bait the fight. The Titan Ward was on Yamin. It just fell off, so they don't necessarily know where all of Epsilon is, but Epsilon, now they're going to be starting up the Fire Giant here. Is Titan going to defend? It looks like they want to based on their positioning.
Kanye and Brotus trying to go in, going to both be silenced, and Kanye pinned in a world of hurt there. Devastating situation for him. He does get out with preemptive strike for a second, but with Adapting chasing, I don't think he'll live for long.
Couple more autos, and Dimmy gonna steal that kill away. 8-1-8. Dimmy having a phenomenal performance, moving over to the Hunter role in his second game at an SPL level.
Teleport in as well, being used by Brotus to try and get back to the engagement quickly. Fire Giant stays standing, though. Epsilon chose not to take it there.
Really, Epsilon not extending their lead too much. I believe it's actually been about 8,000 for quite some time. Yeah, you can see Titan. Titan have actually done... This is really good for Titan, because in the past, I would say, since 17-minute mark, so 6 minutes, the lead has not been extended, which is just a benefit for Titan, because a lot of Epsilon... Actually, Epsilon's still not capped out, but the later the game goes, the less than 8k gold lead.
We're still only at 23 minutes, Adonis. We'll see how this goes on. But once again, Fire Giant started up. Brotus and Ataraxia here to defend. Pretty Prime is on his way over, but he'll be spotted in the mid lane now. And I don't think he'll get here in time, because this Fire Giant is starting to drop very low very quickly. And I think he's going to go down before anyone of Titan can turn up to say hello.
That's going to be it. Pretty Prime had his ultimate, but he wasn't there in place. And now Epsilon, oh, Titan realized that Fire Giant's been completed. Beads by Yamin. He wants to fight. Just immuning out there. And Repikos, he's going to be locked in place under half-life. Titan Are they going to defend this tier 2?
I think they're looking to try and defend it. Blue buff's going to be taken by Epsilon. You can see Dimmy in the lane pushing up that minion wave, so they're going to have them coming. Turret is in support, so wave clear is pretty good on the side of Titan, so they could look to defend this. They're just going to be careful about Beej usage. You get hit by
Beej. Repikos backed, though, and if Epsilon want to take this right now, they should, and you could see them starting to siege it slowly under half. Adapting coming around the corner.
Slowly Titan creeping up in that jungle, just covering the option and keeping himself out of the vision, so they don't know whether the ultimate's going to come
down. I think Epsilon is going to play this safe. They're giving Titan a lot of credit. They've given Titan a lot of credit in the past 6 minutes. This is going to be Gold Furies. This is going to be the remaining tier 2 towers. Well, and it's going to be them backing and spending their
lead.
Let's
be honest. They used to be former scrim partners as well, these two. So they scrimmed a lot together.
Look at that.
So can imagine this has been a situation. But it looks like Epsilon, they're trying to bait into a situation.
Irafer's trying to stay out of combat. He wants to blink and find a cataclysm on multiple players. You can see he's not going to be auto-attacking anything here.
A little bit telegraphed there from the boys, but instead the turret comes in from Kanye at the same time as the blink and cataclysm from Rafa. The ult's out from Prime. Who's he going to dunk onto? Yamin took a lot of damage in the back side, but Emilito on the front side is going to secure the pick on Kanye, and Epsilon push onto the Phoenix.
I don't know if they're going to dive deep into this. Two players really low. Pretty Prime has no beads, and yeah, Epsilon, they're focusing down this Phoenix. They're just trying to keep all of Titan CC'd. Repikos around the corner, though. He's going deep. He's alone 1v4. Yamin just blows him up. Repi dove way too deep. No one on his team was around, and Epsilon take the Phoenix as well.
Quick backs to base from a couple of members as well, as you can see the others.
Yamin jumps into Emilito, and Emilito is backing.
Yep.
He waited till the last second of Emilito's back, and then he jumped in and took the ride with him. Yamin was actually kind of playing a little bit of zone there, making sure they wouldn't stop Emilito's. Just these small plays with Nox, phenomenal.
Jumped inside and went along for the ride. Gold Fury going to be started up by the boys of Epsilon here, and this should go over to them as well. This should be third of the game.
22 kills, 6 kills for Titan, and yeah, this is going to be the third Gold Fury to Epsilon's credit. Only one tower remaining, one Phoenix in the mid lane down. Epsilon, they're in full control of this game. Titan was doing a good job of fighting back. You saw it was only an 8k gold lead for quite some time, but now
game one, it's
just blown up. 16,000 in the lead. It's been doubled in just the past 3 minutes.
Game one, you said you felt that Kepri was the big instrument of success for Epsilon, and that's why Titan's downfall began. What happened in game two then? What's the difference maker here?
It's the Kabrakan, and it's how, I don't want to say useless, but how well Epsilon is playing around it.
Is it the fact that they're not utilizing it, or is it just Epsilon's
I don't think it's not them utilizing it. You can see Titan are trying to force stuff with it, and they do. It's just Epsilon's play around it has been great. They're constantly, the second that Tectonic Rift goes out, the players are targeting a single wall to get the player out, and we've seen it twice with Irafer. We saw it once with Dimmy. It's just Epsilon know how to counter this Kabrakan, and the pick was working for quite some time in both the North American and European scenes, but teams are used to playing against it now.
Tier 2 tower on the left does go down. The second Phoenix is now being assaulted by Epsilon here. The defense is being hit from Titan, but Blink Cataclysm, there's an up from Prime out of sight, but it doesn't find anybody. Meanwhile, Phoenix falls down, and now with Emilito diving in, Titan are forced back.
Rotus ultimate down, 2 blown up. Dimmy finds the last hit on that one. Kanye Life's going to fall too. 2 dead for Titan. Epsilon, they're locking players out of the fountain. That's how far ahead they are. Rapper finds Ataraxia, adapting Aegis is in the fountain, and this is game two. Epsilon right now, they're going to take this one clean.
Another beautiful performance by Epsilon, putting themselves up to 25-1 in the Pro League. That is amazing. They've got, what is it? Is it just two more games? Two more?
Yeah, they faced Paradigm in the last week. Epsilon faced Paradigm in the last week. That's going to give them a lot of competition.
That's insane. If they only lose one game in the entire SPL, this split, that's amazing.
And they lost it to Fnatic, who snowballed them very hard.
That's true. And the scrim partners as well now, which is a good sign for EU as a whole. Titan, though, they do slip to 0-2 in that game, 12 and 14. Let's have a look at First Blood, which went to adapting in this game.
And this was just a combo lockdown. And this adapting did fall here, but they were able to find 2 kills. This is Kanye Life trying to run away, and Repikos actually runs back into the fight there. I don't know if Titan thought they would have the burst to combo with Pretty Prime. That's what I'm assuming. And they did have the burst. They were actually able to lock down adapting and kill him. But
that's right.
Epsilon just kind of locked down the two players that were being overly aggressive.
Well, the solo laner, I mean, the Hunter for Epsilon, at least this game, is going to get MVP. Dimmy is there with that Apollo play, 9-1 and 12, 52.9 FP on Alpha Draft.
For me, it was the 1v3. I'm assuming we're going to see, it's right here. I want to watch this and just, This is why I'm not afraid for Demi at land, because he is so calm under pressure, and that's so important for all players. Epsilon, looking at some of the teams in Europe that are qualified for land already, they have the least experience. It's only been
you
Rapper
say that, but there's a couple of members that have
leave.
Emilito's been to land.
Emilito.
Yamin hasn't been to land, neither has
Demi. Or adapting.
And neither has adapting. So that's the one worry in the back of my mind about how they'll perform at LAN. Hopefully they'll do well. But Demi in this game, great performance from him. Do you reckon we'll see Epsilon do this more in the next game against Paradigm?
I don't know. Paradigm is a little bit different for them. Mm-hmm. This is a team that they... it actually might be the same thing. It's maybe we don't want to give Paradigm our strategies, right? Maybe we don't want to allow Xaelia to feel comfortable facing off against Demi. Maybe we don't want Plumballer to feel comfortable facing off against Emilito. So,
and the first time those two played against each other, Paradigm did come out and say that they felt like they gave a little bit of an opportunity to the boys of Epsilon to really know what they were going to play.
Yeah, I'd say so. Let's take a quick look at who performed the best overall, though. I know Demi had a lot of points there. The Alpha Draft top performers list. Demi, yeah. Demi sitting at the top. Irafer coming in second. Emilito. So Demi and Emilito actually switching game one and game two.
Just like their role switch as well.
Yeah.
Works out just for them. So they show that they can both play different roles. I wonder if next week we'll see Adaptin and Rafer switch roles. That'd be fun.
Don't put a... No Raffer back.
Don't put
Raffer
in the jungle.
Raffer, you were great in the jungle, but
well,
you're leaving it.
I've got good news for you.
You're taking adapting out of the jungle.
You're giving BM shots towards Raffer. He's on the line. Hi, Raffer. How you doing, buddy?
Oh, Raffer.
I don't appreciate this BM. You definitely deserve a $500 fine for that.
A $500 fine to Kevin. We will make sure that he's... What's that? Raffer, how you doing, buddy? Good performance from you guys again. Tough opposition in Titan, but you made it look like a walk in the park.
Yeah, I mean, with the role swap and stuff, we didn't intend on... Well, I honestly don't know. They asked me for this role swap last night, and I know nothing about it. I just said, yeah, sure, because I know both players can play in both roles. So I just gave the go-ahead, because it means the other teams get less experience, you know, with us in our main roles.
That's exactly what we thought over here. When we heard about the role switch, me and Adanis today, we were both sat there going... Well, doesn't this mean that Brotus isn't going to be ready for you guys at LAN, which is a potential opportunity there? And at the same time, Ataraxia back in the Hunter role, not going to be ready for Emilito. That wasn't really the strategy originally then, was it? But it's worked out nicely that way.
I mean, yeah, it worked out. End of the day, we still got the victory and they didn't get the experience. I think they'll still be ready for LAN though, regardless. Personally, I don't think it makes a difference.
Okay, so... We've talked, myself and Hindu have talked about kind of some of your players' inexperience at LAN. Are you worried about that at all, or are you doing any preparation to kind of come around where the fact that it's only been you and Emilito who have gone to a Smite LAN before?
Nah, I don't think the inexperience will affect us, but just the wrecking ball at the minute, just going through all the teams. I just want to keep this up all the way to LAN and hopefully... To Worlds too.
Yeah, Wrecking Ball indeed. Now you've got one more game of the season, I believe, against Paradigm next week. Are we going to see any more role switches happen there?
Maybe. I might have to show the adapting support.
Oh, no. Oh, I'd love to see you jungle. I want to see that GPM. Mm-mm-mm. I'm excited to see if you can actually get some this time, Rafa.
Well, that's another $500 fine right there for you.
How is that BM? I'm just saying, well, see if you can get some GPM. That's not offensive. It's just the truth, right? It's not BM if it's true. Remember that.
Yeah, that's true. That's true.
There you go. So, Rafa, any shout-outs you want to give before we let you go? Fantastic season so far from you guys. Anyone you want to give any love to?
Shout-out to sponsors, Epsilon. Shout-out to my YouTube channel, youtube.com/iRafaGaming. I will be releasing new content soon. And most importantly, shout out to the number 667, my boy.
The number of fantasy points Baskin had.
That's right, 66.7 for Baskin. Thanks, Rafa, for
job,
joining
Baskin.
Us there. Good luck in the rest of the season, and we'll see you at LAN very, very soon, or rather the Super Regionals. Good luck to you. And with that, that's going to close EU set one of the day. We've still got, though, a big matchup over in Europe to play.
Dig versus Luna Conspiracy. Dignitas needing two wins to secure their spot at the Super Regionals. Luna Conspiracy trying to improve their seeding. We'll be back with you with that set in just a moment.